Hey, vinyl community. Once again, I am joined by my good friend, Tim Durling from Tim's Vinyl Confessions. He's been a guest on my show. I've been a guest on Tim's show, and we share a lot of the same common musical interests. And today we are here to show and discuss our Deep Purple CD collection. So welcome, Tim.
Hello, Jeff. Yes, one of the hard rock heavy metal founders, really.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I think if they were like a Mount Rushmore of, you know, heavy metal and hard rock, you'd have to have not only Black Sabbath, Led Zeppelin, but Deep Purple would definitely be up there. And unfortunately, I think between Led Zeppelin, Black Sabbath, and Deep Purple, Deep Purple, for whatever reason, seems to be kind of overlooked. They never seem to get the recognition that I think they deserve. I think they were very instrumental in shaping a lot of the hard rock that came in the late 70s, you know, 80s, and even beyond.
I've said this before, any hard rock band with a keyboard player owes Deep Purple and John Lord. I mean, he legitimized that, because Led Zeppelin and Black Sabbath, even though they have songs that have keyboards on them, they didn't have a dedicated keyboard player. And to be honest, you know, Ritchie Blackmore was one of the greats, but I think a lot of what made Deep Purple heavy was that John Lord Hammond organ rumble that he would get on some of the songs. I mean, I think he would use it the way that it's not supposed to be used. So you'd have this low end stuff that would just sound like massive, especially coming through the speakers, because, you know, Purple had Deep Purple had something a little bit more in common with Black Sabbath as far as the drums were concerned, because Ian Paice is a little bit like Bill Ward in that they had that lighter touch. Neither of them were John Bonham type heavy hitting drummers. So again, the bottom end of Deep Purple came from John Lord, but so many lineup changes and different sounds, but not. Yeah, not like some other bands. There's been actually Ian Paice is now the only guy that's ever played on every single Deep Purple album, and I don't have them all, and I don't think you do either. I by my figuring, I'm missing about 6 studio albums, and there's so many live albums and compilations, and I've got a lot. So what's fun about this is seeing how the ones that we both have differ from each other. So I'll start us off, I guess, with the very first Deep Purple album, 1968, going way, way, way back, Shades of Deep Purple. This has been released with different album covers on them. I can tell already ours is different, because you've got one with the label down in the corner and I don't. What I have here is a version, a US version on Spitfire Records. It's a reissue from, it came out in the year 2000. It's got the original 8 songs on it. And then some unreleased. Oh, okay. So they are similar. They look like they're the same remaster, but a different. What version have you got there, Jeff?
You know, this one, this is on Parlophone.
Okay. So that's a UK, like Parlophone is EMI. Okay. Okay.
Yeah.
You'll be seeing one of those shortly for me. So this is what my disc looks like. And underneath it, it just has the Spitfire logo, and I don't even think Spitfire is in business anymore. I know a couple of Alice Cooper albums, like I think Brutal Planet and Dragon Tan came out with Spitfire. This is what the reissue album covers look like, and the version that another version I've seen. Well, that's interesting. So yeah. You've got so that's okay. So it's the band photo, and then what we have here is like the title of the album, and then the band photo with different shades of purple, but it's repeated. And if you look in the background with the sheet music, what this is the sheet music to Hush, which is a Joe South song, and it was their first single, and right out of the gates, you'd think this band was headed for they did have a legendary career, but this was a top 5 single in the States, was a huge song. Everybody knows it, even if they don't know who sings it, because it doesn't really sound like what you think of when you think of Deep Purple. Now, it's also got a write-up on the early days. This is the Mark I Deep Purple with Rod Evans on vocals, Nick Simper on bass, but then you've got the core of Ritchie Blackmore on guitar, John Lord on keyboards, organ, and Ian Pace on drums. And this band did three albums very, very quickly. And anybody that's curious about collecting Deep Purple, you're going to find in your travels some very, very cheap-looking versions of these first three albums, especially on cassette. And Jeff, you know what I'm talking about. Oh, because yeah. For some reason, I think that the rights must have... Nobody, I don't know who actually has the rights to these albums, but there's a company, the main one is Creative Sounds Limited, wherever they're from. And they put out some really cheap-looking versions of these albums. So they've been issued so many times. Between the first three Deep Purple albums and compilations of those songs and the Alice Cooper Toronto performance from 1969, which they keep putting out with different covers, and you think that it's something else, but it's not. And two of the songs generally aren't even Alice. We'll get into talk about Alice Cooper, but it's the same company that keeps putting these things out for the unsuspecting, you know, consumer. They're like truck stop CDs or tapes, you know, like you don't. And so I really wanted to find good, legitimate versions of these early Deep Purple albums. So that's the first album. And also in 1968, in very short order, the second Deep Purple album came out, The Book of Taliesin. Interesting cover. It's actually got the first names of each of the band members and what instruments they play. It's hard to see on CD. You can see it better on the album. And this is another Spitfire version for me from the US, and it is a 2000 remaster with some unreleased songs. Another thing about the first three Deep Purple albums, a lot of cover songs, right? They cover the Beatles, they cover Cream, they cover Jimi Hendrix. On this album, they actually scored a top 40 single with, I like what they did with it. They covered Neil Diamond's Kentucky Woman. It wasn't as successful as Hush, but more so than Hush, I think that sounds a little bit more like the Deep Purple sound we would come to know, because there's a lot of stuff in the middle of it where they're just jamming. Right. Yeah, they're similar on the CD's minds. Yours looks more blue.
Yeah, and the title's up here right underneath.
Yeah. So it's different. Yeah. So you have another Parlophone EMI version.
Does yours have tracks?
What's that?
Does yours have bonus tracks?
It does, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. And I think what we have is the same issue. It's just they were licensed to different companies. But these are legitimate issues. And I can't say I listen to this stuff all that much, but I do like, you know, I do like Hush and I do like Kentucky Woman.
And Ring That Neck, that's a song, didn't they? That's on their most recent one, isn't there a version of
you're on the right track. What they did is they redid the instrumental and the address,
okay,
which is the opening track on Shades of Deep Purple. They redo that on their most recent album, which we will get to. The next one came out, it's a convoluted story, because if you read, I think even as this album was coming out, the core of like Blackmore, Pace, and Lord decided they wanted to go in a heavier direction. They wanted a different bass player and a different singer. So even as this third album was coming out, I think they were making plans on changing the lineup. So we may have the same version of this next one. It was self-titled and it came out. Yeah, I think we have the same version because it's got the EMI Harvest logo on here. This is a UK EMI version. It's got bonus tracks on it too. There were no real hits off of this one. One of the more interesting parts about this is the cover. And this was by a guy, I can't remember his first name, but his last name was Bosch. And I think it's called The Garden of Earthly Delights. And anyone who's a Black Sabbath fan who has their greatest hits album, it's got another portion of this cover somewhere on it. It's like a hell on earth, nightmare scape. The more you look at it, the more disturbing it becomes. And they use part of this for the cover.
And I think the original painting was in color, if I'm not mistaken, like it's right on here, but yeah.
So this has the booklet explaining. This goes into the most detail about how, you know, the two guys were sort of, you know, hip checked out of their position in the band. So like I said before, these three albums have been compiled umpteen times. This CD is technically, it says 1987 on it, but it's not. This Abomination is from this Creative Sounds Limited. So this is from the time period they were just throwing things out. It's called The Best of Deep Purple. So someone, I picked this up quick, said, okay, I want Smoke on the Water and Highway Start. No, you don't get any of that. And this is one of those irritating ones where the printing is upside down, which just drives me no end of crazy. So the back, and it's exactly, I mean, okay, at least it does have Hush and Kentucky Woman on it, because those are the only hits they had at this point. But first of all, look at this cover. This skips, never mind Mark II, never mind Ian Gillan or Roger Glover. This is the Mark III lineup. This is David Coverdale and Glenn Hughes. So it's just sloppy all around, right? This is what the disc itself looks like this, and on cassette, they were equally as cheap. What I really would like to see, as far as a Best of Deep Purple from these early years, and I got the vinyl out to show, I actually would like to see a CD with this cover on it. This is a Canadian record that calls itself Best of Deep Purple. And again, it's Best of the Early Years, but it's on Polydor. So it's actually on a major label. This was Canada's, they've been on different labels in different countries, but this is what I would like to see a CD of for that. So I don't think it ever was, but that's why I got that Best of CD to kind of fill that spot.
Yeah, well, not the first artist that a record company tried to mislead the public by using a more recent photograph, repackaging old material with a much more recent photograph. Probably, I would imagine, you know, back when Ian Gillan was back in the lineup and maybe trying to, you know, jump on that bandwagon a little bit. But yeah, I hate when they do that. I think you've got maybe an Alice Cooper CD that does the same thing where they take, a concert, but use
them. Yeah, it's that Toronto concert that's been, you know, and there's a picture of Alice and you can clearly see Kane Roberts on one side, and I think Kip Winger on the other. So it's from like the Constrictor era, and somebody might pick it up. And what really happens is that I would hate for a younger person who's curious about Alice Cooper to pick that up and listen to it and go, this sucks, and never go any further. It's like, don't do that. And right. Likewise for Deep Purple. I mean, if you get a CD called The Best of Deep Purple and say, well, this is stupid, it doesn't have Smoke in the Water, it doesn't have Knocking at Your Back Door, it doesn't have Burn, it doesn't have any of those songs on it, what is the point of all this? So yeah, right. I think that's one of the valuable things about why we do things like this, sort of hopefully educate for those that don't know. I don't know about you. I have it on vinyl, but I don't have the, whatever the heck it's called, the Concerto for Group and Orchestra, which, whatever. That's the first thing that the most famous lineup of Deep Purple, the Mark II lineup, put out with Ian Gillan on vocals and Roger Glover on bass. And so the one that matters is the one that came out in 1970. And it is Deep Purple in Rock. You mentioned Mount Rushmore. Well, here it is. You've got two copies of that. Now, my this one here is a Canadian copy on Warner Brothers. And, you know, this is the same as the record. They did not do much. It's the same picture on the back cover. Although, you know, we've seen like really bad cover art. At least they didn't have this as the front cover and then the rear image is the back cover.
Right.
Some bands probably would have done that. This is, I think, a remarkable album. You know, for its age, this is one of the building blocks of what would become known as hard rock and heavy metal. This has Speed King on it. It's got Hard Lovin' Man, which is jig, 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 jig. I mean, that predicted so many songs. Into the Fire, Bloodsucker. Bloodsucker is another one that they redid in later years. This is a great album. Now, I'll talk about it later. There's a song on here that they're well known for. It's really, really long, but I'll talk about that later. This actually has the lyrics in it, and it's actually got like a brief little one-line description of each song. And like a lot of early Warner Brothers CDs, there's a page of notes on it. So what versions have you got, Jeff?
So I've got, you know, same, looks are like pretty much the same version, except this is an American version of original Warner Brothers release. And then this is a remaster, and I'm not sure what year this is from. I believe it was pretty recent. I can't read the year on this dark background here, but this is what the back cover looks like. And then the CD is just a band shot here. And then there are some bonus tracks on here, but this is a pretty sizable book. I mean, you've got essays in here, shots of different singles, and, you know, kind of the whatever recording notes. Maybe
I like that when they do that. Yeah. And I like the shots of the singles from, especially from other parts of the world. Is that a Rhino reissue?
Yeah, this is this is 19.
Yeah, I know they're so small, but
it's so small, but yeah, this was the Rhino one.
Yeah, great album. So then they were off and running with the Mark II version. It didn't last very long. They did put out a lot of music in the meantime. So the next one I have is 1971 Fireball. This is the only one that I have on the Warner Flashback series. Other than this, though, it's the only thing that's different. The catalog number is the same. The back of it is the same. The side is the same. The CD itself looks the same, you know, just like an old Warner Brothers CD. This is just the version of this that I found. Fireball, oh, this one also has the lyrics in it, which is interesting. Now, Fireball is a little bit different than the one that came before and the one after it, because there aren't as many what I would call Deep Purple standards on this one. Obviously, the title song is killer. It's one of the first, I think, one of the first songs to use double bass drums. Strange Kind of Woman is another popular song off this. I know they've done the Mule in concert. Other than that, the other songs kind of just live on here for the most part. I know they've done Anyone's Daughter, and like on, I think they do an acoustic, or that's on one of their many live albums. But this one's interesting because it's kind of got hidden songs on it, even though this was in the midst of their really popular period.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I really like the track Fools on here. I think that's kind of a, you know, epic suite that it's one of my favorites. But yeah, no, it's a great album. It really, you know, it's not as heavy as In Rock, but I think it's definitely, you know, one of their classic albums from, you know, that Mark II lineup.
It kind of lives in the shadow of the, it's kind of in between the two big ones. And you're right, overall, it isn't as heavy. But
yeah, the two that bookended it were so fantastic that it really gets overlooked, unfortunately.
So next one, I'm guessing you've got multiple versions of this or different than mine. 1972, Machine Head. This is just a Canadian version on Warner Brothers. This is the single biggest selling Deep Purple album because it has the song, Smoke on the Water is on this. But this album is just packed with classics. I've never been sick of Highway Star. I've always got time to listen to Highway Star. I love Space Truckin'. Actually, Ace Frehley recorded Space Truckin' on his Origins Volume 2 album, made for him, even though it not just because it's got space in it, but it just sounds like something he would do. I like Pictures of Home. Like, this is a great album. This is a great album. And just your standard looking Warner CD there. Looks like we got the same version of that. Classic album art. Not that it's great album art, but it's classic because it was such a big album. It's got these shots that were also in the vinyl. And what I think is interesting too, this has another page of the notes that they put in some of the early CDs. And there's a mistake on the very last paragraph. It talked about them reuniting in 1984. I'm guessing these notes were written in the early days of putting up CDs. So it was probably pretty recent. Deep Purple's most successful lineup reformed, recorded the album Perfect Strangers, and embarked on a final tour. It was not the final tour. It was a reunion tour of the Mark II lineup. So that was a fail.
Well, they a little presumptuous that was going to be their last tour. But this is a Rhino Warner Archives reissue. This is the two disc. One disc has Roger Glover remixes of the album, and then the second disc has the original album just remastered.
Cool.
Like that. And then this again is another real thick book. It almost doesn't fit in the little, you know, tabs there, but
little spindles, yeah, or yeah, tabs, yeah.
Yeah, but you got, you know, again, you got essays, you got photographs, there's, you know, some newspaper clippings, excerpts from that, but, you know, a lot to take in, a lot to read. It's really, you know, I like these almost like mini biographies that they include, really extensive notes and a lot of historical background about the album. And, you know, like you said, this was definitely, if anybody owns a Deep Purple album, at least one of their studio releases, it's going to be this.
That's the one, yeah. Yeah. Rhino always does a good job with those reissues too. And actually, Machine Head is one of those albums that inspired an entire tribute album. And I don't have it, even though I like a lot of the artists on it, but there is a machine, I think it's called Machine Head Revisited or something, that came out in maybe 10 years ago. Chickenfoot is on it. Metallica is on it. A lot of people are on doing songs from Machine Head and the Machine Head period. Like, for instance, Metallica does the song When a Blind Man Cries, which was a B-side of one of the, I think Never Before was the single. So, yeah. So the next thing I have, Deep Purple have done so many live albums, you know, they're a little bit like Yes. I think there's more live albums than there are albums, but this is a quintessential classic double live album from the 70s, made in Japan. I've got a Canadian version on Warner Brothers, a version I have. Yeah, I think we got the same. Yours looks like the same, except US. It's only got seven songs on it, but a little bit like Led Zeppelin's song remains the same. This is by far a short album. And it's all Mark II era things. I never really understood this front cover, like a lot of wasted space on here. And if you're going to put a band, a hard rock band on an album cover, don't put the singer behind the bongo drums. It's just kind of weird. That's the CD itself. And the booklet, this is the reprint of what's inside of the record, the gatefold, individual shots, the band. It also is kind of neat because it does say where all of these songs were recorded. You know, some were recorded in Osaka, some were recorded in Tokyo, and the exact dates. Again, a page of notes about it. And I know there's been several reissues of this album and deluxe editions. This is the only one that I have.
Yeah, I think we've got the same version of that one too. So
now we're at the point where I'm starting to miss some things. I don't have their next studio album, the last Mark II studio album, Who Do We Think We Are? So I'll let you take this one.
Yeah, this is another reissue because it's got seven bonus tracks. It's got a 99 remix of Woman from Tokyo. It's got an version of Woman from Tokyo with an alternate bridge. It's got a song, Painted Horse, Our Lady, a 99 remix, a writing session for Rat Bat Blue, a 99 remix of Rat Bat Blue, and then First Day Jam, which is just an instrumental. But yeah, this was kind of the burnout album for them. They'd been on tour, heavily on tour with Machine Head, and then they really got rushed into the studio, I think, before they were ready. Not that this is a bad album. I think it's a good album. I think it could have been a lot stronger if they hadn't just been pushed into the studio and like, all right, come on, come up with something else brilliant. And I know, you know, Ian Gillan had given that as one of the reasons why he's just like, you know what, I'm out. I can't do this anymore after this album. But, you know, it's the end of the first, you know, true classic era. If you don't count the Rod Evans, you know, I almost feel like, well, the real Deep Purple started with in rock. And, but, you know, it's the fourth Mark II lineup album. And, you know, it's solid. I don't like it as much as I like the three albums that came before, but it's not a bad album overall.
Strange album cover too. I have it on vinyl. And it's, I think if you look really close, each of those bubbles has one of the band members' faces. That they didn't have the best cover art. Let's be honest. They really didn't.
Yeah, well, with every album they were doing... Yeah, they're doing something with their faces, as you'll see as we start getting into the next couple of albums. Just really bizarre, almost like they were just kind of having fun with it, and they just stick their faces on any old thing. And, you know, bubbles here, they got that comet trail behind them from Fireball and Rock, they're the Mount Rushmore, and machine head. You got kind of that the reflection and that steel. So, yeah, very unique.
That Woman from Tokyo is really the only song on that. It's the only song from that that ends up on compilations, it seems. So, and Ian Gillan and Ritchie Blackmore, famously, they never really got along. A little bit like, you know, like Don Dokken and George Lynch 10 years later. It's like, how did you even end up doing one album? Never mind a handful of them. So exactly. Now we're on to the Mark III Deep Purple. And it's interesting because I grew up in the 80s and I'm a little younger. I was into Whitesnake long before I was into Deep Purple. And Whitesnake was a spinoff band, of which there were three. There was Whitesnake, Rainbow, and Gillan, which is Ian Gillan's band, who were big in the UK, and they didn't really do much of anything in North America. But so I was into Whitesnake, and in reading, because I always like to know about these things, I knew that David Coverdale had been in Deep Purple, and that Ian Paice and John Lord were also in Whitesnake. So at one point, there was a Whitesnake lineup that had the six guys in them, half of them were Deep Purple. It's also interesting, I don't know if you ever noticed this or not, but in the hiatus period, when like between 76 and 84, when there wasn't any Deep Purple albums, that they still had colors in Rainbow and Whitesnake. I don't know if that was on purpose or if it just so happened that way. But the Deep Purple era got off to a good start, I think, Mark III in 1974 with this album, Burn. And I'm pretty sure that we've got similar versions of these. Yeah.
Yeah, I've actually got two. You're the one. You actually got this one for me.
Yeah, that's why I knew that for sure.
Yeah, during the pandemic. And so this was the first version I had, which looks like the version that you have there.
Yeah, it's a Rhino reissue. I think yours is, mine's Canadian. I think ours are both the same. They're Canadian versions.
Yeah.
And what I also like is the CD itself is made to look like the Purple Records label. Mm-hmm. So that would have been on the record itself. This also lists, at the time, the other things that were available through Rhino, including something I don't have, their box set that came out in 1998 called Shades. That might be good to get at some point. But yeah, you're right. They're doing weird things with the faces now. Okay, so they're candles. And really, I mean, you can tell a little bit, but really the only one you can look at right away, and you know who it is, Ritchie Blackmore, because he's got his top hat on. You can tell that's John Lord, and you know that's David Coverdale. I guess that's Ian Paice. That must be Glenn Hughes. So this is really cool. Again, it's got articles. It's got like concert ticket, or concert advertisements. It talks all about how they got this unknown singer, David Coverdale, because Glenn Hughes was a known, like he was in the band Trapeze. So he was a known commodity. He'd recorded, he toured, but Coverdale was a complete newbie to the music business. He'd never recorded professionally. He'd never, if you've seen some of the early photos, he didn't know how to dress. I mean, it's really, you know, it's that voice, right? The voice is what say, oh, we got to get this guy. And Coverdale claims, I read an interview with him in Classic Rock magazine, that the tape that they heard of him jamming, he was completely drunk, completely wasted. His diction was terrible, but there was something about the tone of the voice that they, And really, there'd be no Whitesnake if it weren't for them hiring him, because this got him his start. This is a great, great, great album. The title song is killer. It's a heavy, fast one. Mistreated has been redone several times. Mistreated is a song that has so many legs on it because Coverdale continued to do it with Whitesnake. Blackmore did it with Rainbow on the On Stage album. So you've got verses of this with Coverdale singing it. You got verses of Dio singing it. Like everybody said, no, that's going to be one of our songs. Might Just Take Your Life, this was actually a single off this. It wasn't successful, which is kind of an odd choice, I think. Coverdale and Hughes split the vocals on much of these songs. This has there's an instrumental. The last proper track on this is called A200, which there's a very naughty reason it's called A200. I'll leave that for people to look up. There's some remixes on here, and there's something called Coronarius Redig, and I don't know if that's an acronym or an anagram for something. It probably is something very naughty, knowing them. And this reissue is from 2005, and a good start to the Mark III lineup. Of the three albums, it's my favorite of this lineup.
Well, I had read too, I think they actually approached Paul Rogers about replacing Ian Gillan, and Paul Rogers was more interested. You know, Free was breaking up, and Paul Rogers decided, you know, he really wanted to start Bad Company. So he was already in the process of that, but that'd be interesting to see what that would have looked like. But yeah, I'm one of these weird guys that I like to get the original releases on CD. You know, I do that with my Led Zeppelin. I do that with my Black Sabbath. I do that with Beatles, whatever. I there's just something I like about having the original reissue. So I found this like about, I don't know, like a month ago, and I just grabbed it because it was really cheap. I think it was like $4. And I thought, well, this is cool because the covers are, and I'm, that's another thing. If the cover's different, I'm a sucker to go and buy it. But if you can.
Okay. A little different shade of, okay.
And the Burn, yeah, that's a little bigger.
That's interesting because I've never seen the original CD of Burn. I've never ever seen it before. So but it's one of those things where it's like, I already know what it's going to look like because if it's an original Warner Brothers CD, and I think that this is the only one, I think you might prove me wrong, but I think it's the only one of the Mark III that there's a US version of originally.
Yeah, that could be. That's the last one that I've got on Warner, you know, that looks like this.
But yeah.
I thought it was, I'd never ever seen that original version. I'd always, you know, see that much anyway, but I thought it was cool and grabbed it.
So the next album came out later the same year. This is an era where bands were just pumping them out. It's the second Mark III album, one of my favorite album covers. Actually, it's one of my favorite logos. They were one of those bands like Rush that never had a logo that they stuck with. I really like this one. Mm-hmm. I don't know why. I just do. This is Stormbringer. And the version I have is a UK version on EMI, which was their, we might have the same version. Printing.
Yeah.
Yeah. I think we do have the same version. I wonder if the CD looks like. That's typical of, we do have the same version. That's really cool. Well, so this one, go ahead.
Was this ever remastered?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, there'd be remastered versions of it for sure. It's got hardly anything inside of it for credits. The title song, Stormbringer, another classic. Stormbringer and Burn are the most well-known songs from the Coverdale era of Deep Purple for sure. There's another song on here called Soldier of Fortune is one that went well into the Whitesnake era too. Coverdale would usually do this as an acoustic song. And what's cool about this cover, there's a couple things. Now, number one, this same image, and I can't remember whose image it is or what it's called, but there's an album by the group Susie and the Banshees that uses this. It's in black and white, but if you look at it, you go, yeah, that's the same picture. Okay. And my understanding is that if you stack this, I could have grabbed it, but if you stack this up against the first Rainbow album, Ritchie Blackmore's Rainbow, it completes one arc.
Yeah, was that intentional or was that just a coincidence?
It wouldn't surprise me if it was, you know, knowing Blackmore, because this was the last album he did with them for a while. Mm-hmm. That's probably his way of saying, follow me.
Right. Yeah.
So the next thing that I have came out in 75. I have read that it came out in the States, but I've never seen an actual US copy of it. It came out in the UK, and for some reason it came out in Canada. And I say that's strange because usually if you have like an international band, a big band, for an album to come out in Canada, but not in the States is kind of strange. The good example I always use is Queen's album, Live Magic, which came out in 1986, but it wasn't released in the US for 10 more years, but it did come out in Canada in 1986, which is odd. So I'm talking about another compilation, 24 Karat Purple. This came out in 1975. I've got an 8-track, a cassette, and a record all from Canada. I've never seen a US copy. They're all on Warner Brothers. This is on EMI. And it's just a 8 song compilation. It's all, it's all Mark II stuff. And this is what it looks like on the side. And what I find is fascinating about this, that's the CD itself, it's the division of EMI called Fame, which I've got some Queen and some Whitesnake stuff with that on it. But this obviously came out quite a long time ago as they were in the process of reissuing things on CD because, all right, so it says, the 8 classic Deep Purple tracks in this compact disc are taken from these 5 classic albums. So you have Fireball, Machine Head, and Who Do We Think We Are available on LP, cassette, and compact disc. Made in Japan, available on LP and cassette, not compact disc. And Pour in Rock, which at this time wasn't available on anything. So to me, that's a real snapshot in time of when this would have came out. I bought it used, so I have no idea what it dates back to. I just really wanted to have this on CD.
Boring cover, though.
Very, very, just very. Yeah. So next thing, the what would be the last Deep Purple album for 9 years, studio album, came out in 1975. By now, Blackmore's out, and they've got Tommy Bolin. And Tommy Bolin was a member of, I think he was with the James Gang. I think he replaced Joe Walsh in the James Gang, if I've got that right. He was in a band called Zephyr. He ended up briefly, at least playing on some songs from a Canadian band called Moxie, which I really don't know much about. But, and also, most people my age know the name Tommy Bolin because of his solo song Teaser, which Motley Crue recorded in 1989. And if you're a Motley Crue fan and you know that song, listen to Tommy Bolin's version. It's very, very similar. They were very faithful to his version of it. So Tommy Bolin joins the band. So this is the Mark IV lineup that only lasted one studio album, Come Taste the Band. You've obviously got, yeah, that's a remastered version. This is another EMI CD from probably from the late 80s. I bought it used again. There's the CD itself and that cover of the booklet. And this actually has all the lyrics reprinted from the record, which is odd. When you buy these old CDs, you just don't know what you're going to get. Sometimes they don't put any work into it. Sometimes they've got pretty much everything. But you have obviously got yourself a remastered edition. And yeah, let's see that one.
Yeah, so this is a 2-disc one. You've got the original album on the first disc, and then there's a 2010 remix of the album, which is on the second disc. Again, with, you know,
the Purple Records.
Yep. And then this is the entire Deep Purple catalog, if you can see that there.
Yeah.
And then this is what the other disc looks like. It's just kind of got the band members' faces in a circle there.
Yeah. Weird, again, weird covers. Like weird artwork. Yeah.
Very strange. And they are like, okay, one of the weirdest covers ever, but that's Deep Purple for you. It's really, you know, definitely in character for them to have something so unique and bizarre like that. But, you know, same as the other reissues, you've got newspaper clippings, you've got photographs, there's an essay there. I love this album to death.
Yeah.
I think this is a fantastic album with the addition of Tommy Bolin. It's just got a real interesting kind of a boogie rock to it, you know, which is unique for Deep Purple, but I think it works well. I think Glenn Hughes and David Coverdale are great vocalists, and I was not prepared to like this as much as I do, but I think this is a great album.
And I think this album, more than any other of the three Coverdale albums, that really paves the way for the early Whitesnake. So if somebody's got like Snakebite, Trouble, Love Hunter, Ready and Willing, you'd probably like this album. Maybe not so much Stormbringer or Burn, but this album kind of, not that Tommy Bolin sounds anything like Mickey Moody or Bernie Marsden, but it's got that sound. And again, you've got three guys there that would go on, even though John, and somebody will correct me on this, but I know John Lord and Ian Paice weren't originally in Whitesnake. I know there was a different keyboard player and a different drummer originally, but when it solidified, you still had that foundation of those three guys. So yeah, so Tommy Bolin unfortunately dies of a heroin overdose very young. I think he was only 24, very young. And there's several live albums from that lineup in different parts of the world. But the one that I'd really like to get, I have it on vinyl and 8-track, is called Made in Europe. That's hard to find on CD. I don't know that was ever released domestically on CD unless it's a remastered version. So I do not have that one. The next thing I have came out in 1978, another compilation, fairly easy to find. And it's called When We Rock, and When We Roll, which is a mouthful of an album cover. I usually just refer to it as When We Rock, We Rock. I've got a Canadian version on Warner Brothers. Yours is probably the same, except it's US. Yeah, my CD looks exactly the same. Now, what's interesting about this is it combines the eras, because it's got Space Truckin', Kentucky Woman, Hard Road or Ring That Neck, Burn, live version of Woman from Tokyo, Hush, Smoke on the Water, and Highway Star. So it really, this collects all their hits or all their best known songs to this point. It's not a bad compilation to throw on and listen to. I kind of actually like the cover. It's kind of Star Trek looking, you know, has nothing to do with Deep Purple, but I like it. You really can't go wrong picking this up just to have something to throw on and listen to. And if you just know some of their songs, this isn't a bad one to get.
Sure, if you don't mind the live versions of those two tracks. But
yeah, they're not the studio versions for sure. And I think that's one of the reasons why it was only 2 years later that they did it again. EMI did it in the UK and Warner Brothers did it in North America. Probably the most common Deep Purple compilation, I think, at least historically, is Deepest Purple, the very best of Deep Purple. Not bad in the cover art, you know, it's got the Stratocaster, which is Blackmore's weapon of choice. This is a Canadian version. This is still something you can get, and the stores will continue to keep this. And you know, it's worth mentioning that if stores continue to keep things in stock, they'll continue to sell. But if they don't carry them, or they go out of print, you're never going to sell any more copies. So they keep repressing this one. This has got 12 songs. This is a solid compilation. It is all these recordings are studio cuts compiled by EMI Records in conjunction with Ian Pace, which is kind of interesting. There's the Purple Records logo. These are all Mark II cuts, with the exception of Burn and Stormbringer. The other thing that was of some value when this came out is this is the first time that Black Knight appeared on an album in its studio version, because even though, like, to me, I think of it as being on In Rock, but it's not, unless you get a deluxe version. It was a single by itself. It's one of the more popular songs. This also has a song called Demon's Eye, which is on some versions of the Fireball album that came out in parts of the world instead of Strange Kind of Woman. So I guess they put both of those songs on here, so to cover the bases, so to speak. There's the disc itself. And there's not much in here, although there's more than what you might expect. Just talks about how they were remastered and, you know, state-of-the-art sound quality as of 1980, right? Which, you know, considering some of these recordings are 10 years old. Photos of the group, not very good photos. I mean, that's Glenn Hughes, but you can't even see his face. It's all blurry. And, but, you know, at least they do have all of the players that were involved in these recordings. So, again, this is a pretty good compilation too, but it doesn't have any of the Mark I stuff on it.
Right.
The next thing I have is, this is a really funny story, but it's something that you really have to look on the internet kind of hard to find anything out about. So as I said before, Deep Purple as an entity, as a recording touring group, didn't exist between the years of 1976 and 1984. There was Gillan, Rainbow, Whitesnake. And it should be mentioned that all of those bands had fluctuating lineup changes too. It's insane to keep track of all that. But so turn of the 80s, late 70s, early 80s, a version of Deep Purple started to play shows that was Rod Evans, the original vocalist, and a bunch of other guys. And apparently there was a promoter who was doing this with classic bands that were, let's say, dormant, if that's the word for it, dormant, because I guess he did it with Steppenwolf too, basically throwing these guys together. They're using a well-known like brand and putting them out on tour. Now, nowadays, that happens too, but the difference is it's usually sanctioned. I mean, if you think of Whitesnake, it's only David Coverdale. if you think of Foreigner, sometimes they would do concerts without even Mick Jones. But back then, it was a huge deal. And the, you know, the entity that is Deep Purple as far as management and contracts put a swift end to it. And from what I understand, they were terrible. This band was terrible. They couldn't play. And it wasn't like they were going out doing all Mark One stuff. They would go out and try to do Burn and stuff like that. And like Rod Evans doesn't sound anything like Coverdale or Glenn Hughes or Ian Gillan at all. He's a crooner. But so I don't know if you ever heard about that, but it's just like, so because that was going on, members of the Deep Purple fan club petitioned to get their BBC recordings released. And this originally came out in 1982. Oddly enough, in North America, it came out on Portrait CBS Records, which is very strange to me. I don't know why that is. It didn't come out on Warner Brothers or whatever. But, and I don't have it on anything else but this. It's simply called Deep Purple in Concert. And what I have here is a version that came out in 2001 on Eagle, which is a UK label that's put out lots of DVDs and CDs. But they all seem to have this cover here. And this is Mark II, 1970 to 1972 recordings. This has also, I believe, been released under the name Live and Rare. So it's one of those things where you might have it even if you don't think that you do. So this is two different recordings, December 1st, or no, night, no, it doesn't. That doesn't say December, it's a disc. Disc one is from 1970. And what's interesting about that is they're dipping back into the Mark I. They've got Ring That Neck and Mandrake Root on here. Disc two is from 1972, so it's mostly Machine Head stuff, but they also cover Little Richard's Lucille. That's what the disc one looks like, and disc two. The booklet in here explains a lot about how this recording came to be. And so, like a lot of BBC recordings, it's funny because it's recorded in front of a very small audience. So you've got the host, and I'm not sure who the host is, I should know, introduced by Mike Harding, okay, saying, all right, on stage here, we've got Deep Purple, they're going to do their first number, this is called Speed King, and then they, you know, go into that, it's like, all right, that was called Speed King, you know, so it's got this, it's really kind of quaint, but most of these British bands did BBC recordings, which is really cool, because eventually they'll come out. But my funny story about this is that, so my daughter and I were driving, and both of my kids really, they've got a pretty good taste in classic rock because of me. They've gone back and listened to stuff. Deep Purple is a band that neither of them really got into, but, and I didn't really have it on that loud. We were driving and talking, but second track on disc one is Child in Time. And so I'm not even really noticing it, but at a certain point, the conversation drifts off and Marley starts listening. And it's the part where it's like, ah, like where Ian Gillan's just screaming. And so she just very politely says, Dad, what is this? I had to share that story. So yeah, that's Deep Purple in Concert, the album. So
that's funny.
Now I think we're going to get back into something we both have for sure. So the Mark II lineup reunites after Rainbow puts out, I think, seven studio albums in a very short amount of time. They had just come off, you know, their most successful period with Joel and Turner, that's my favorite period because I like them more. I really like Straight Between the Eyes, but that's another story. So they just come off Bent Out of Shape and toured Japan. Whitesnake, of course, the revolving door of members. It's getting to where it's the slided in era. So John Lord and Ian Pace had already left. I think he went to play with Gary Moore. John Lord had left, even though he played on the slided in album. And Ian Gillan was fresh from his one album stint with Black Sabbath on the Born Again album. This brings these guys back together for a fantastic album, Perfect Strangers. And you've probably gotten an original version. I would think.
I don't know.
Nope, we got the same one.
Yeah.
So this came out in 1984 on Mercury or Polydor, Polygram, wherever. Yeah. And this is the 1999 reissue. And mine's US, so we're probably got this exact same version. Original album had eight tracks on it. the cassette and the original CD had 9 tracks on it because it added the song Not Responsible. The reissue has another song on it, a 10-minute long, I think really meandering instrumental called Son of a Lyric, which was a B-side. But this brought Deep Purple back into the public consciousness. This was a successful album. It was a million seller. They had a fairly well-known, it hit the top 100. It didn't hit the top 40, but Knocking at Your Back Door, which is just a fantastic song. I never get tired of it. As soon as that opening comes on with the doot, 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 with the, and the drums come in on the offbeat, it's so awesome. The title song, Perfect Strangers, is the other well-known song on here. It's very Kashmir sounding, very Eastern sounding. You could almost picture, you can almost hear Dio singing this song, I think. This is, I almost wonder if Blackmore didn't have that left over from the Rainbow time period, but Under the Gun is great. Nobody's Home is great. This is a good album. This is one of the best, I think, Deep Purple albums. So this one and In Rock might be my favorites from start to finish.
Yeah, this was very much helped out, I think, by the MTV exposure that they had for videos that were on here. It was kind of like in the same way 90125 was helped out by MTV.
Yeah.
You know, this was very much when MTV was showing videos. And, you know, I think Knocking on Your Back Door was in pretty heavy rotation back then.
Yeah.
That's where I first heard it, actually.
Yeah.
I'm like, oh, and, wow, that sounds like classic Deep Purple. It's very.
And wisely, they didn't try to glam up, you know? And if I recall correctly, the Knocking at Your Back Door video, there's just live footage of them, but it's mostly like a post-apocalyptic, which a lot of videos were doing at the time. If you think of like Kiss, Lick It Up, and Motley Crue, Too Young to Fall in Love, there was a lot of these Mad Max looking things, like, you know, after the aftermath of the nuclear war, but it got the song in people's heads, and it's still like it's a mainstay of their concerts. Like that one, Perfect Strangers, I think, you know, all the way up till the last time they played live, you're always going to hear those two songs. So surprisingly, I don't know why, but they weren't able to maintain that quality. I know they were constantly fighting. And of the two albums that they did, because they only did two as a reunited band at this point, the next one didn't come out until 1987. It's hard to find on CD. I've got the remastered version of The House of Blue Light. I think that the first track on here, Bad Attitude, is every bit as good as anything on Perfect Strangers. It sounds like it just picks right up. But to me, this album just isn't as good. I'm glad to have it, of course. And it's not bad. It sounds like Deep Purple, and it sounds like that lineup, but the songs just aren't as memorable, or if they are, they're memorable for the wrong reasons. They put Call of the Wild on here, and I think that's just an awful song. It's just cheesy. And the video's even worse. The joke is that the band didn't want to be in the video, so they got all these other people lip syncing, and it's just hasn't aged well. The Bad Attitude video is pretty cool because it's just them in the studio. I think that one's all right. So this one's got the lyrics and the credits, and then this is from the record itself. It's got the band members' photos and, let me see, what else is on this? Mad Dog's okay, it's kind of a fast one. Mitzi Dupree is kind of a silly, slow, bluesy thing. I don't think it's very good, but yeah. This album did not do nearly as well. I think in some parts of the world it did, but it ended up in the delete bins pretty quick. And I don't even know if there was a US or Canadian CD made for this, which is surprising because it's 1987, but it's really hard to find. This, like Perfect Strangers, is the 99 reissue.
I've never seen that one, so.
The next one, it's surprisingly easier to find, but I think I know why it is. They did another live album before breaking up again. And it came out in 1988 called Nobody's Perfect. And we probably have the same version, except that I've got a Canadian version. It's on Mercury. Actually, yours is Mercury, mine's Polydor. It's all Polygram. It's all the same company. It's just a different division of it. And I don't know, mine's got a nice purple CD. How many tracks are on yours?
11.
Yeah. So I think if you have it on vinyl, which I don't, maybe probably on cassette too, there's more songs. Now, I will say this. I like the one studio track that's on here. They remade Hush, which is kind of cool because it's a version of Hush from the Mark II lineup. And they do you know, they do the predictable songs. They do Perfect Strangers Knocking at Your Back Door. Hard Lovin' Woman's the only one from the then current album that's on here. I don't know why they didn't do Bad Attitude on here. They probably did it live. Other than that, it's Highway Star, Strange Kind of Woman, Child in Time. Like, I don't know why they always have to do Child in Time, but one of these songs, like right in the middle of it, Ian Gillan goes into, I think it's Every Day by Buddy Holly, starts singing that. And then he starts talking about, last night I saw the Buddy Holly story on TV. He was tremendous. Like, so very, very lighthearted, you know, and, yeah. And the artwork is just kind of whatever, you know. This actually, like the Made in Japan, does say where each of these songs were recorded, which is kind of interesting.
Well, the interesting thing about this is if you see this in a store, you would have no idea this was a live album. It does not say Deep Purple Live anywhere on here. For all intents and purposes, somebody would pick this up and think, oh, it must be another great compilation, but it's not.
Which is why I think it's never been out of print.
Yeah.
I think it's the name recognition.
Sure.
So at this point in time, Jeff, I'm missing a ton of stuff. Like, I don't have the next studio album.
Okay. Well, I've got, so the next thing that I've got, and this is part of
these. I've seen this.
Yeah. And so I think the next three albums, this has got the Mark St. John, if I'm not mistaken.
That's Jolynn Turner.
Okay.
Yeah. So it's Jolynn Turner.
Jolynn Turner. Okay.
Slaves and Masters. That's 1990. And if you might have expected, okay, so it's got Jolynn Turner, Ritchie Blackmore, and Roger Glover, you might think it would sound like Rainbow. Well, it pretty much is. It's pretty much the follow-up to Bent Out of Shape. I really like it. Jolynn Turner's a great singer. Does it sound like Deep Purple? No. But at this point, like, Gillan and Blackmore were at an all-time low, I think. I think it might have actually got physical at this point. I don't know. They were auditioning other singers, and they had another guy lined up to go. I can't think of his name, but then they needed somebody at the last minute, and Jolynn Turner was fresh from a stint with Yngwie Malmsteen singing on what I think is the only decent Yngwie Malmsteen album, Odyssey. I love that album. And they brought him in, and they put this album out. It got, like, the first track on it, King of Dreams, got some airplay. I remember there was a video to that song. That's not a bad sounding song, but again, it's like Deep Rainbow. It doesn't really sound, because his voice, you know, like, takes up so much of the sonics. Yeah, you've got John Lord in there. You can tell his sound a mile away. The Cut Runs Deep's a good one. Fire in the Basement's good, but it's a pretty forgettable album for the most part. It was the first one they did, I think, for RCA, and it didn't. It was, you know, that lineup did not last. So the next thing to talk about, and you've got the next studio album, but I've got something that came out in 92. Just real quick, and it's just a PolyGram compilation called Knocking at Your Back Door, the best Deep Purple in the 80s, and you can pretty much guess what's on it. It's got all the predictable songs from Perfect Strangers. It's got, you know, a couple of things from House of Blue Light. It's got the studio version of Hush, and then it's got some various live versions from Nobody's Perfect, because that's all that PolyGram had to choose from at the time, and this is one of many. This is a U.S. Version. It's a Columbia House issue. So now, 1993, the very last, Mark II.
Yeah, I was going to say, too, they didn't get very imaginative with that cover either. They just basically blew up the cover of Perfect Stranger.
Exactly.
This is The Battle Rages On. And actually, Ritchie Blackmore, I believe this was his final album with Deep Purple. And he has characterized it. He calls The Cattle Grazes On. Because he thought, you know, we're just going through the motions, and he did not care for this album at all. I've got the version that was in the box set, but then I've also got this version, which was a standalone CD of this one.
The title song is really good. The title song is really heavy.
It is very heavy, and it's a little, you know, you're kind of taken aback a little bit if you're expecting another, you know, Perfect Strangers, Knocking on Your Back Door type stuff. But this has all the lyrics, if you can read them, because the printing is very small, but credits and whatnot in this one.
And for once, not a bad album cover.
No, you got the almost, you know, the logo that
PD's
lineup was using.
Which is interesting.
Yeah, I like the dragon. I don't know. I think it's cool. I think it's got character. I wish they would settle on a deep purple logo and just use it, but they didn't. Whatever. It's just fun being nitpicky, but I would really. Yeah. They got some great logos that they've had in the past. I just wish, consistency.
I know that in 94, there was another live album from that tour. I think it was called Come Hell or High Water. I don't have that one. So Blackmore's gone for good for Deep Purple. He does one more Rainbow album with a bunch of guys, which I've never heard. I've never heard a note of it, and I'll eventually get it. It's called Stranger in a Saw. So he's like the scarecrow with the top hat. In a kind of a strange thing. So he leaves, I think, in the middle of the tour. So they get Joe Satriani to join the band to finish the tour dates, I guess it's a little bit like Steve Vai and Whitesnake. It's like, well, yeah, he's a great guitar player, but does he fit? I don't know. And I'm sure there's live recordings of that. I've never actually heard any of the live recordings. So it's like some places list him as having been a member of Deep Purple. I really don't think he was. I really think that was more just to get the tour done. That they didn't, you know, it's almost like, was Vivian Campbell a member of Whitesnake? He didn't do any of the studio albums. Yeah. He appeared in the videos and he did the tour. But anyway, so Deep Purple enter into, surprisingly, like as much as the Mark II lineup is loved, they weren't together very long. They had three different, they were like a couple that keeps getting back together and divorcing. So then they get Steve Morse on guitar, who of course was in the Dixie Dregs. I know him basically because he was on a couple of Kansas albums, including one of my favorites, Power. And he had his own band, and they put out several, you know, albums. He's a fantastic guitarist, and he's been with them ever since. And the first album to come out, I think Some Parts of the World came out in 95. The version I have came out in 96, called Perpendicular. And I've got a Canadian version here, which is the last one that's on RCA. I don't think it was on RCA in the States, but okay, so get back to that thing about the sides of the CDs being upside down. Creative Sounds Limited, you know, cheap little company, whatever. RCA should know better than this. Like, to me, it's just so sloppy. This, speaking of sloppy, it's hard to read this writing.
Yeah, it's almost impossible.
That's what the disc itself looks like. But now my complaints are over, because I think this is a really good album. Like, this is a really, really good album. Right away, it's obvious that Blackmore is nowhere to be found on here. Steve Morse has definitely his own sound and, you know, makes it known on here. And there are just some really cool riffs, really cool solos. Deep Purple are not a band that were known for ballads or slow type songs, but there's a song here called Sometimes I Feel Like Screaming that is just excellent. It's just, I don't know if you'd call it a ballad so much. It's definitely got ballady parts. The chorus is a little more upbeat, but it's got some beautiful guitar work. Like, Steve Morse plays this melody and it changes keys so many times. It's all over the place. Like, I'm Not Your Lover is a great song. Ted the Mechanic is kind of funny, but it's a cool song too. Yeah, I really like this album. I think this was a good start to this, whatever mark we're on now.
Yeah, no, it is. And, you know, Deep Purple has just been, each album has been heavier and heavier, it feels like, you know, as it's gone on. They didn't lighten their sound. They didn't mellow out, you know, with age. It wasn't like, well, it's time to kind of, you know, tone it down a little bit. And, you know, they've just full steam ahead. They've been really a solid hard rock band from this point forward.
Yeah, the next album I don't have came out in 98, and it's called Abandon. Abandon, or A Band On. Same lineup. And again, live albums galore. The next thing I have came out in 2000. And nowadays, if, you know, people just find their CDs at Walmart or whatever, it's worth picking up because you can get it for like $8. The very best of Deep Purple. Yeah, we probably both have the same version. I think mine's a Canadian Columbia House version, but this is a Rhino reissue. Usually this is what they do. You'd put a box set out, and then the next thing that would come out is a single disc version or a condensed version. This is the, okay, I don't know if you've ever noticed this before. There's 15 tracks on here. They're the exact same 12 tracks that are on the Deepest Purple compilation. All they did was add Hush and Kentucky Woman to the front and Knocking at Your Back Door till the end. So this becomes probably the best, if you're going to get one thing by Deep Purple and you're curious to check them out, is to get this. Everything sounds really good on here. It's remastered really well. So because you've got songs from all over the eras, and it's a pretty consistent sound. And as all Rhino releases, there's all kinds of cool photos here. Very old photo of the band there, and the black and white one. And really good liner notes from a couple of guys that, let me get their names here, Greg Burke and Dave Van Heusen. And I think that they were like Deep Purple fan club guys, but they wrote the liner notes, but they also wrote a little descriptor of each song on here. But the other thing that I really like that Rhino does, they list all of the Deep Purple albums, all of whoever's albums are doing, and their chart positions. I think that's really cool. Not to mention the songs themselves, they put how they did as singles. There's some, at least some backstage passes. So yeah, solid compilation. There's no live tracks on here. It's all the studio tracks, the way they were originally meant to be heard, because Deep Purple are one of those bands that would take a 5-minute song and stretch it out till it's a half an hour long and takes up one whole side of a record. So, but what you get here is the guts of Deep Purple for sure.
Yeah. Not crazy about that cover either, but I mean, it's a great compilation if you can.
Yeah.
Overlook that. Yeah.
So I don't, I'm missing like the next two Deep Purple studio albums. The next one that came out was in 2003. Talk about bad album covers. It's called Bananas.
Oh.
And the one thing I will say about that album, and I've never heard anything off it, it's the same lineup with Steve Morse. But apparently that album is way expensive on vinyl. Like, you cannot find that on vinyl. You can get it CD fairly cheap, but you can't find it on vinyl. Next thing that came up was 2 years later, 2005, another album I've never heard called Rapture of the Deep. Don't have that one either. I can see you don't either.
No.
The next thing I've got, I didn't come out until 2012, and it's just part of a series. It's part of a Universal series called Icon, and I don't have many of these. I picked this up just when I thought, well, I'll get a few Deep Purple albums, but this is really pointless because it's basically a condensed version of that previous best of that took the Perfect Strangers logo. Like, there's 12 tracks on here, so it's even shorter. The only good thing about it is that it's the thing that's now available. So for $5, someone can introduce themselves to Deep Purple. Yet again, the classic songs on here are the Nobody's Perfect version. So, whatever. I do have the next studio album to talk about. Now, something interesting. So John Lord retired from Deep Purple at some point, and he passed away, sadly, in 2012, but he'd already retired. And his replacement and the guy that's still with him today is Don Airey. Now, Don Airey is a keyboard player, is like a journeyman keyboard player. And so he's crossed paths with these guys before because he was in Whitesnake. He played with, wasn't Whitesnake. He was in Rainbow. Yeah, he was in Rainbow. He played with Ozzy. He's like played with a ton of like British bands. So he took over for John Lord. And then they ended up for the very first time, even though he's a legendary producer and they're a legendary band, hooking up with Bob Ezrin, classic Canadian producer, and he'd say no more. And the first thing that this conglomeration came up with was Now What? Yeah. So we probably got the same version. Cause I got mine in the US. It's on Eagle Records.
Yeah.
Yeah. I think we've got the exact same version. Again, kind of a pointless title. The only thing I could say about it is that it stands out. And it's also the disc itself has that on it. And another good album. What are your thoughts about this one?
Yeah, I like this one a lot. I really like the Bob Ezrin stuff that they did. This new era that they went into. I think it's fantastic. It's heavy, but at the same time, it's not like if you're not a heavy metal, hard rock fan, you're still going to find a lot to appreciate because it does sound like Deep Purple. It's just a very heavy version of Deep Purple, but I find there's a lot of melody on here. I find the songs are great. It's 11 tracks, so it's not overly long. You're not like, okay, when's the CD going to be over with already? So I like it a lot. And it's nice they have the little dedication.
Dedication to John Lord, yeah.
Yeah.
So that photo of the Mark V, Mark VI lineup, whatever you want to call them now. And this is the lineup that still exists now. I mean, this has been, they've been together now for almost 10 years, you know, and they've done a lot of touring before the pandemic. Again, live albums, compilations, almost always coming out, I would say. The next Deep Purple album, it's actually the first one I bought new, came out in 2017. It's called Infinite. And so you've got like a deluxe version. Mine's on Edel or EDEL. It's got 10 tracks on it, once again, with Bob Ezrin producing. I think this is a really good album, too. I think this is my favorite of the three. Pretty thick booklet, actually. And they're going with this like Arctic theme for some reason on this album, like they're up in Alaska or somewhere. But yeah, quite good. Now I'm curious to see what your version has.
So mine is a two-disc version, and I'm going to complain about the packaging here, because for a two-disc version, number one, I'm not a big fan of digipacks, and I'm especially not a fan of digipacks when you staple the book very sloppily on the inside here, and then it pops out. So not only that, but I've lost the staple now, so this book is starting to, you know, come apart.
Yeah,
like that. So it just irritates me, and there's not anywhere to like stick it now. So, you know, I have to just kind of shove it in here and then like this. But anyway, packaging aside, so first disc is a studio album. The second disc is live at Hullfest 2017. And you've got some of the, you know, more recent tracks on here, but you've also got Fireball, Strange Kind of Woman, Lazy, Perfect Strangers, Space Truckin', Smoke on the Water, Peter Gunn theme right into the track Hush, and then Black Knight. So, you know, it's cool to have that, that extra bonus track here. You know, again, my only complaint is I really wish they would have just stuck it in a jewel case.
Yeah. It's my Metallica Death Magnetic is kind of like that. Cause I got, if I waited, I'd have gotten a jewel case version, like the week, if I'd have waited like a week, that's what they would have carried in the stores. But I got that version, which it falls out every time. It just flops everywhere. I hate it. So the last thing I have to talk about, I did a review episode of this on Tim's Final Confessions, is the most recent Deep Purple album, Whoosh. And we probably have the same version. It's from Germany, but I think it came from the US. And again, you know, Bob Ezrin producing. Does your version have the bonus song on it, Dancing in My Sleep?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. This is broken up into Act 1 and Act 2. And there's the disc itself. I like this logo. Maybe they stick with this logo now. Who knows? I think my favorite one is still the Stormbringer one. But yeah, now I don't like how the lyrics are printed here. I remember when I was in English class in high school, there you'd write poems that were where the words ended up being in the shape of something. And I thought it was annoying then. And I think it's annoying now. Yeah, I think there's some good tracks on here. I don't think it's quite as good as Infinite, but it's good. And they do, like we said before, they remake the very first track on their very first album, Man the Address, which is just kind of a cool instrumental, but it's nice to hear an updated version of it. But yeah, and who knows if they're, you know, we might see another one from them.
But I feel like too, you know, this logo, the font that they use for this is very similar to the one from their first album.
So, oh, yeah.
It is. Yeah, I mean it's not identical, but
no, because the R of the new one goes below. But yeah, you're right. That's a very similar font. It might be a version of the same font.
Right. So not only did they, you know, take the first track from their first album, but they also kind of updated that logo that was on the original album. So I thought that was pretty cool. But I like that album a lot. For me, this is my favorite of the three Bob Ezrin albums. And I don't know because I played it so much over the last year, but I really like it a lot. And, you know, if you want a deeper dive into that album, a great review, Tim on his channel has a full episode dedicated to the Whoosh.
Yeah, so it's fun to say, it's fun to spell. pretty amazing when you think about it that a band whose first album came out in 1968 released another album in 2020. It's pretty amazing. Nobody back then would have thought these bands would have been around that long, and the bands themselves didn't think they'd be around that long, because bands had a short lifespan. Look at the Beatles. I mean, there's a wealth of music. It's the foundations of most of the bands that came after, because yes, everybody says they were influenced by Led Zeppelin. A lot of the metal bands were influenced by Black Sabbath, but you talk to people like Lars Ulrich or even Aerosmith was influenced by Deep Purple. So, you know, their influence is just, dare I say, infinite. You know, they were the building blocks.
Yep. No question. Absolutely. And look how long it took them to get into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame, which speaks to just
ridiculous. You know, also, a very antagonistic band, too, because famously Ritchie Blackmore didn't show up. Apparently, they did not want Coverdale or Glenn Hughes to speak, which is ridiculous. They totally blacklisted Rod Evans and Nick Simper. You know, I think if you were in the band, you should have been, you know, you should have been on stage accepting, even though there were a lot of the guys on that stage. Steve Morris wasn't up there. Don Airey wasn't up there, you know. It's crazy. But I can see now, that especially looking at all of this, like, got a long way to go to complete this collection, but it's having fun along the way anyway.
Yeah, no, absolutely. But thanks so much again, because I knew you knew all the history, the dates, the members coming and going. And that's one of the reasons why I really love having Tim as a guest, because he has such an extensive knowledge. He can tell you the labels, and he can tell you all of the little details that sometimes, you know, we're not even aware of. But make sure you check out Tim's channel. Again, it's Tim's Vinyl Confessions. And what you saw today is everything that you'll see on Tim's channel. He goes through his CD collections, his vinyl collections. He's got 8 tracks. He's got cassettes. I've been a longtime fan of Tim's channel, and so I appreciate having you helping me out today with my Deep Purple CD collection and showing what you have. And we'll look forward to hopefully more collaborations in the future.
Definitely. Thank you, Jeff. Thank you very much. I appreciate it. And we've got some dual episodes coming up, as a matter of fact, on my channel. So yeah, if you're following Jeff, you'll see him on a lot of my shows too. So, but thanks for having me. It's always a good time.
Yep. Thanks.